Close your eyes. Relax. Now, most people, they close their eyes. See if you can sense where the center of gravity is in your body. Most people, when they close their eyes, the center of gravity is actually in their head. They're still in the head region. So I want you to do this. So you feel it in the head region, in the eyes, even though the eyes are closed. So we have five senses, right? Eye, ear, nose, tongue, body. The mind being another faculty. Now, don't use your eyes. Withdraw your sense faculties, functions of hearing. Except my voice, of course, and then smell and taste, and only isolate on the sense of touch, the faculty of the body. Now, have the eyes closed, you may feel your top heavy, the center of gravity is up there. Now, very quickly, feel the tactile sensation at the buttocks, the sense of weight, grounded, touching your seat. Maybe the lower back, if there's tension there, relax it. Allow the sense of bodily weight to sink down to your seat. So very quickly, the center of gravity now is at the base. No longer at the head. You can't think your way, you have to feel. That's why I ask you to isolate the sense faculty of the body. Tactile sensations. Okay, now let's try this to do the progressive relaxation. From head to toe. Don't think about it. Don't imagine it. Don't visualize it. Only through the felt sensation. Okay? So bring your sensation to the crown of your head. See if you can feel. And allow that sensation to trickle down to the forehead. Especially the space between the eyebrows. This is where we hold a lot of tension. Okay? So raise your eyebrows up, in other words, tense up, hold, and release. Let them drop suddenly. Okay? Do it a few times. Raise them up, release. Get a good feel of what it is like to release the tension there. Feeling the skin, feeling the muscles, tactile sensations. Now, extend the sense of release to your eyelids. Feeling the skin. Don't use your eyes to see. Pretend the eyes can't see anything. Now feel your eyeballs. You have a lot of tension over here too. Feel your eyeballs. See if you can feel tension. release. If you can feel the contours, the weight, allow that sense of release, relaxation now to extend to the planes of your cheeks. All this is done through tactile sensations. Okay. Feel your jaw. Follow the jaw line all the way to your chin, tucking the chin a little bit. And then feel your lips. You can wet your lips. Feel the corners of your mouth gently, gently smiling. And take a moment to savor this experience. Just experiencing. You can even sense subtle shift in the undercurrent feeling tone of how we feel in the present. Just with that gentle smile. Pleasant. So soak it in. Let's go to the top of the head again. On the front of the cranium, I want you to sweep back to the back of the cranium. Take your time. So the scalp. Feel the skin. See if you can feel the skin. See if you can feel the pores. At least with the intention opening all the pores, all the follicles of hair, relaxing. Relaxing the scalp. Opening all the pores. Relaxing each follicle of hair. Sweep all the way to the back of the cranium. From the back of the cranium, now flow down the neck. Tactile sensations, okay? Feeling the skin. Muscles. You can rotate your neck to get a good feel if you want. And the mind is clear. Clearly experiencing. So what is actually happening? Not how we wish to happen, how we imagine. Concrete tactile sensation. Now the shoulders. As you inhale, gently raise the shoulders up towards your ears. Hold. Exhale through your mouth and let the shoulders drop. Feel the sense of release. Again. Okay. See if you can feel your arms, both arms. Feel the skin, muscles, tendons. elbows. And now the forearms. And the wrists. And the palms and the fingertips. Maybe the warmth of the palms. Wiggle your fingers a little bit. Get a good feel. Relaxing section by section. Now let's come to the chest. Now, our breath is subtle, quiet, smooth. It's the benefit of relaxing. Now we can actually feel the subtle rise and fall of the chest, following the rhythm of the breath. Very subtle. Your mind has to be very clear to pick up these sensations. Releasing any tension. Breath is subtle and set up. The mind has to be sharp. Now, you can use the exhalations and we can sense truly the sense of gravity of the body, the sense of weight. Now, exhale. As you exhale, allow the bodily weight to sink down into the abdomen. You can do it again with the next exhalation and the next exhalation. Get a good feel for this. Now you can feel the gravity. Center gravity of the body. As you exhale, sink down. Abdomen. Now you can get a good feel of the subtle movements over there. Rise and fall. Following the rhythm of the breath. Don't force your breath. Natural, gentle. So the mind is clear and more refined. The concentration. Okay, let's go to the back. Back of the neck to back of the shoulder. Are there any subtle tension, tightness there? We're focusing on the back, but you can still raise your shoulders up and let them drop. Feel this as a release. Back of the shoulders. Feel the shoulder blades. Mid back. And you notice there's still movements there. Movements rise and fall by the rhythm of the breath. So not only is our front of the body, the chest, expanding, contracting very subtly, the back is doing the same. This is why we don't sit leaning our back on a chair in meditation. The back must be free from any obstructions in order to truly settle down. You can use your exhalation, exhale, drop the body weight down. The smaller back, the lumbar area, lower back, and let it naturally sink down to the buttocks. Our seat connected to earth, the ground. There still may be some subtle tension, especially the lower back. So this is what we do. Sway your body gently from left to right. Find a center point of gravity where the spine can naturally erect. Each vertebrae stacked on top of the other. Left to right, and sway front and back. Find the center point, center axis. Sometimes when we concentrate, people tend to lean forward. Okay, so I want you to really find the center. Then allow the weight to sink down. Now, upper body. Light as a feather, almost non-existent, no tension anywhere. Then we continue relaxing the hips, thighs, and knees, feeling the skin. Muscles and tendons. At least the intention is there. Calves, ankles, and feet. Until you end at the soles of the feet. And then allow the sense of bodily weight to simply melt into earth, into the ground. Now we place the hands in the meditation posture in the Chan Zen tradition. Palms up, right palm on top of the left palm, thumbs touching. Forming a natural connection, resting on our lap. Now, sometimes people do this and their shoulders tense up again, so I want you to relax the shoulders. Resting on the lap. You can use a towel to prop up so your hands are not slouching, kind of dragging your upper body to slouch. It must be an angle to your elbow. So use a towel, rest. Complete completely embodied, experiencing the presence, the reality of sitting. Relaxed and grounded to earth. Feel the sense of, still through tactile sensations, feel or experience the weight of the body. The motionlessness. Feel the stillness of the body. Rooted. Now, the body is taken care of. The body is primed. Let's take care of the heart. How do you actually feel? This moment. See if you can feel the undercurrent feeling tone. Your mood, present experience. A gentle smile. At ease, content. So please familiarize yourself, bask in this experiencing for a moment. Now, with this experiencing of being relaxed, grounded, content, one more ingredient. That is, we have to sharpen the mind with great, great interest. Being the breath. The freshness. Tactile sensation of each breath. Experiencing the newness. Let's all do this together. See if you can feel the nostrils. The subtle breath or wind passing through the nostrils. Moment is new. Next, bring the experiencing of the breath at your abdomen, no longer at the nostrils. Now bring it to the abdomen. What's the experience there? Resist from labeling, giving words, notions, just experiencing. Eyes can open or close, but you're not using the eyes. You're using the faculty of the body, experiencing. Leave behind the abdomen. Segue to directly experiencing the sitting itself. Which is the reality of this moment. Experiencing clearly. The sitting. In this moment. These three are one. Embodied experiencing. The reality of sitting. And the present. There's no separation. The present is the sitting. The sitting is experiencing. Moment to moment. Wakeful. Embodied. The slightest trace of haziness, drowsiness. You have to rotate your neck, wake yourself up. Wakeful. Experiencing sitting. Now, I want you to zero in on the experiencing, the qualities of experiencing. There's a freshness to it. Free from wandering thoughts. Before even thoughts arise, can possibly arise. And there's a bodily component to it. It's embodied. The body is so still. It's as if there is no body. Just experiencing. What is this like? Don't label it. Don't put a word to it. There's no need. It's not awareness. It's not emptiness. It's not clarity. And you're not asleep. Experiencing. Alive and awake. There are no stages. There's no inside or outside. Yet it's vibrant. No need for an object of experiencing either. Usually people think when they're clear, what they really mean is they're clear of something. There's no need for an object, just experiencing. Mind's natural function. wandering thoughts arise, even if wandering thoughts arise, there's a freshness, newness to it. The quality is still there. The thoughts liberate themselves. Allow your eyes to open. Seeing. Not seeing an object or anything, but the experiencing. Happen to be experiencing through the faculty of sight. The experiencing is unobstructed. No inside, outside. Experience the habit tendency to label things as your eyes open. Label what you see. Just allow them to dissolve. Into experiencing. Eyes open. Now, let's open the ears, faculty of hearing. Not the heard, but the experiencing. Of hearing itself. Not defined, limited to sound. Infinite, unobstructed. Now, even if you have physical discomfort, embodied experiencing that. Just the experiencing, not that which you experience. But you don't suppress that either. Physical discomfort, yes. The experiencing of that. No reactivity. Not so bad. No label, no words. We'll come out of meditation. Slowly. Join your palms. And then place your palms on your knees. Slowly rotate the body. Experiencing. One direction, change direction. Slowly wake up the body. Rubbing your hands together. Place the warmth of your palms over the eyes. Allow the warmth to come in and relaxing the eyes. Do this a couple of times. The whole face. Use your fingers to massage the scalp. Still experiencing. Place your thumb at the base of the cranium. Press in to massage. And massage the neck. Massage the shoulders, muscle squeeze, joints rub, muscle squeeze. Good care of the body. No words or language, no labeling. Pull your fingers. I usually use, can I clamp my fingers with two other fingers of the other hand. It makes a snapping sound. Relax. Massage the chest both directions. directions. Abdomen. One direction only. The direction of the internal organs. So if you're looking at me, you do just the opposite. Cage. Use your knuckles to massage two sides of the spine. Don't crisscross, just massage. Circular motion. Then you can use the back of your hands to massage. When you get to the lower back, put your palms there. And rub. Create heat. Then the legs, massage the legs, muscles squeeze, joints rub, squeeze the calves, like that. How long do you sit? Forty-5 minutes. Okay. Well, this evening is almost over. Much better than talking. Talking these words, you can read the book. I'm sure after some time, someone will PDF the book. It'll be floating around the internet. If you don't have the book. Now, we went through different approaches all in one swoop, in one period. But just a little taste of it. But people typically, you know, they do what's comfortable, what's natural, and they stay with it, develop deeper concentration. How was your sitting? Questions? We can begin with that. Or share some experience.
I have a question.
Yes, please.
In another talk on silent illumination that you gave, you once mentioned that your teacher Sheng Yan, when he first taught silent illumination, his instructions were to basically not engage the mind in any way, in yes. any of the senses,
yes.
or even the breath. Mm-hmm. And my question is, when we're sitting, I find that there are a few things that I feel like are almost, are kind of essential to use at least some part of the mind to maintain, such as posture. And I was just wondering, like, for example, if I'm not being mindful of my posture, then my posture will inevitably distort over the duration of a sit, which detracts from the quality of the session. So I was wondering if I'm using some part of my mind to keep track of my posture or to be mindful of that my breathing is correct, or little things like this, is that detracting from the practice of silent illumination?
Okay, thank you for the question. The short answer is no, it's not detracting. There is no fixed silent illumination practice. Okay. Silent illumination is the expression of awakening. We can use the principles and apply it to different methods of practice. Okay? So when he taught 76, 77, told his students not to use any of the senses. Let go of eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, mind. Sit. And don't fall asleep. right? When he did that, basically no one could know how to do it. So he stopped teaching like that. So people need anchors. They need something for the mind to rest on. And that's what we've been doing. Now, there is something that strings together all the different approaches that we just did. Do you know what that is? It's not really, you know, the nose, and then we went to the stomach, rise and fall, and then just the sitting. And as you got to open the eyes. Even if wandering thoughts come, remember what I said? So even if wandering thoughts come, there's a freshness to that. The thing that strings together every stages or every approach is experiencing. Now, it may seem abstract to non-practitioners. Experiencing, of course, we're experiencing, but the experiencing that I'm talking about is very palpable. It's embodied. Now, it happens to be, when we first began, embodied experiencing the breath. So, the experiencing, the breath, and the present moment, these three are one. Remember that? The present is the experiencing. The present is the breath. The breath is experiencing. So these three. It just so happens that there's a little something more concrete there. And then maybe more subtle, the abdomen. Even more subtle, the reality of this moment, which is sitting. So all these, for lack of a better term, objects for the mind to rest on, what strings together everything is the moment-to-moment-to-moment freshness experiencing. Until I had you guys, you know, even eyes open, ears open, it's not the object, it's just the experiencing itself. That's the nature of mind, the nature of being. I don't even want to call it mind, as if it's separate from the body. It's just the nature of being. That's the way I phrase it. Why do I phrase it like that? To get away from the typical jargon in Buddhist literature, you know, early Buddhist texts experience it, describe it a certain way, Mahayana experience it, describe it a certain way, Tibetan Buddhism describe it a certain way. It's just different cultural context, different linguistic baggage, different paradigms that they're using, but basically, it's just what is mind? Did you have to give a label to it? Like the Tibetans, they say, clarity and knowing. Yeah, clarity and knowing, or something like that. Like you practice Dzogchen, right? Is that how they describe it?
There's a lot of words for a lot of different things.
A lot of words for different things. These words, don't rely on words. Don't rely on words. Words are, people say words are like fingers pointing at the moon. The words are not even fingers pointing at the moon, really. The words point to other words. The words themselves exist in a whole system by itself. So these signifiers, these words, they point to each other. The most important thing is personal experiencing. You see? So it's possible to not use eye, ears, nose, tongue, body, mind. Yeah, of course, we do have eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, mind, and sitting. But that's the state where the mind does not abide, rest, anchor in anything. It's just moment to moment natural freshness. Okay? Is there a self there? There is no self there. But for most people, there's still attachment there. Because of attachment, self coming to being, self-referencing coming to being. So it's not that there's a self and then the self attaches. It doesn't work that way. There is no self. But through attachment, habit tendencies, that when people do that practice that we did, it's not awakening. It's kind of a proxy of it, you know, coarse proxy of it. But understanding the principle of non-abiding, one slowly kind of align oneself with the principle. So the principles become experiencing. And the words drop away. The referencing drop away. And the eventually grasping drop away. But what happens when grasping drops away? Awakening. Senses, do they work? Of course. Much better. Much freer. The thinking, is there thinking work? Thinking doesn't work. Of course it works. Feeling, is there a feeling? Yeah, feelings. It's no longer contingent on objects, things. But we have a tendency to reify everything to things. No longer contingent. So most people things, and then they see it, and then they give rise to all kinds of notions. Is there a response? Of course. The self-referencing, absent. But the mind functions very clearly. That's the free, natural state of who we are. I call it natural awakening, silent illumination. You mentioned, is it right or is it wrong? Is it straight off of the method, silent? There's no right or wrong. Different people use different things. You need more anchor, okay, focus on the breath. You need something more concrete, okay, do that. But understand the principle. What strings through everything is embodied experiencing. And then you don't even need the embodiment, just experiencing. It's like a rough, coarse approximation of it until self-referencing drops away. This practice itself cannot stand alone. It must be built on the foundation of Dharma practice, practicing of generosity, practicing of virtue, practicing of patience, diligence, determination, and compassion. It must be built on that. Because all these comes at the self-referencing from different angles. Kind of work with it. If you just rely on sitting meditation, nothing. Nothing. It must be holistic. Different aspect of your life. Then maybe with this referential attachment, habit tendency, suddenly drops away. Maybe it comes back, and then you have to continue practice. Offering yourself to the natural freedom of this moment. Like making an offering, offering yourself. Whatever task at hand, offer yourself with gratitude. Cleaning the toilet, engaging, healing racial trauma, social engagement, anything, offering this moment. Okay? So all that principle of silent illumination. That's the long answer. Okay. So in that answer, I've described a little bit about silent illumination. I don't have to talk about silent illumination anymore, right? You kind of get different angles. Through your questions, your sharing of what we just did, then maybe more things will come up. So anyone would like to share? Yes, please.
Thanks. I like your repeated pointing to the freshness. And as I was thinking, I can't really remember exactly how it happened when we were meditating, but like, I'm thinking of fresh moments, you know, like the moment I go and first start a really nice, warm, relaxing shower, that it's so fresh right at first. And then it's like, oh, I've done this before, so now I don't need to let it be fresh anymore. Or my wife brought home some lavender, and you crush the little flowers, and immediately it's like, it's so alive and big, huge. And then like my mind makes it smaller and smaller and smaller. I just wonder your comments about my experience.
Yeah, you know, our discursive mind, I like that. But I want you to, when the discursive mind rises, experience the freshness of the discursive mind.
Oh.
Experience that. Just because the nature of who we are is freshness. We complicate things, and we lose sight of it. But in that complication, even when you get angry, you get irritated, there's a freshness quality in it. Try it.
Okay.
There's a freshness quality to everything. Wandering thoughts, you know, irritation, lavender crushed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's a good exercise. Freshness. Things that we don't typically experience as fresh. And there's not only freshness, there's a directness. There's an immediacy. Now, if we trail off into our discursive realm, notions, oh, this is a lavender, why isn't it purple? Color is a little different than last time she brought it. If we trail off in that, immediately come back to, if you want to remember two words, freshness, directness. Even the freshness and directness of the trailing off, just come right back. Slowly introduce that to everything that you do. You can make a discipline out of it. Every time you do the same old stuff routine, come at it with freshness, directness. And then, you know, the ups and downs, the difficulties, the ease with which we experience things, all that start to balance and merge. Until you get to a point where someone is crazy, is just screaming at you, there's a freshness to it. Smile. There's a freshness to it. Okay. Come on. Please.
So that freshness is happening right now. The way you are impacting us, me. Yeah.
There's no me, there's no you, just freshness. Right here, freshness. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
Yes. When I've gone to week-long sessions up at our monastery, by the end of the week, my mind is very quiet and everything, not everything, but things are very fresh and very direct. And I go home and it's gone in 48 hours. What happens? Why does that happen?
Habit, tendency. You know, there's no such thing as self that we're trying to get rid of. There's no such thing as self. What is it? It's just habit tendency. Habit tendency of reifying, solidifying things. You know, this person is just that way. That person, this thing is just like that. It's like this habit of seeing things the way what we think it is. Habit, that habit runs deep. So try to introduce what I said, the freshness in the little things that you do throughout the day. First sip of water, tea, first bite of lunch, like innocuous thing, little things, right? Don't wait for the session. Just little things. You pick up your glasses. You wear glasses. You pick up your glasses. So the weight of it on the bridge of your nose. Take it off. How you close it. Start with routine things that you do that you don't think is fresh. Start with them. At least the first minute of it, you're infusing it. Just fully, fully present. And then the minute will start to extend to other areas of life, the next moment. You do that for 3 months. Just experiment. Pick five things that you do every day. Same stroll, walk, same bite of lunch, first bite, brushing your teeth, the shower, the conversation with someone. Infuse that. The world becomes your path. The world just unfolds in this freshness. Even someone, if you have someone, it would be great, but you may have to work your way up to it. This is a little difficult. Someone that you know that's annoying, irritating, or things that don't go smooth, pick that after 3 months. Just see it, just experience that freshness. It's always available. It's always present. It's already here. Yeah. Okay. So, because of that, I know a lot of practitioners, they tend to seek for things, for experiences, for this and that. Because of that, there's no need to seek for anything. Seeking entails lacking, gaining, losing. I don't have it. I want that. practice cannot be grounded in seeking mind. Already here. Already present. Avail ourselves to this. Okay. Anyone else? Anita, are you still there?
Anita, I'm here, sir. Princeton. I'm here. I'm here.
How was the sitting?
It's okay. It was good. It was good. I am trying to soak it all in, and I'm gonna have to go back and practice more. But what I'm bringing with what I'm bringing is just not me, not you, just the energy that is here. It's that came through the sitting was phenomenal. It was phenomenal. It was something that is still here.
Okay. Savor it. Don't try to hold on to it. The more you try to hold on to it, it will escape you. Just relax into it. Just relax. Avail yourself.
Yeah, it is. It's beautiful.
Okay. I'll try to.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Raquel?
Thank you. It was refreshing to have a similar experience as to the one that I had during the retreat.
I can't hear you, but you're smiling, so I'm guessing everything's okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Is this better now?
Yeah, it's a little bit better.
Yes. Yeah. So thank you for the talk this evening. I was just saying it was very refreshing to have a similar experience sitting as I did during the five-day retreat, being able to really focus on that grounding as a foundation for the rest of that time. Mm-hmm. And it's very beneficial and something that I discovered I need to continue to practice.
Yes. Practice. Bits and pieces throughout the day. You know, we did it for a while, you know, progressive relaxation and grounding, but we can do it very quickly. I gave you a little taste of it. You know how when I first began, I said, close our eyes, and you feel like it's basically the center of gravity is here, right? And I said, bring it right down to the buttocks. And then it went there, right? Just, it's not here anymore. Just right here. That's how quick. The immediacy. How can it be that quick? Because there's no mind. There's no such fixed thing like muscle. Like muscle, if you try to build muscle, then it takes time. Like this material thing. But the mind, the swiftness of the mind, immediately can bring down and to ground yourself. So you can do that throughout the day. Do the other bits and pieces. Spread it out. Yeah. Okay. So, you know, the book is a little bit stiff, kind of structured. Chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, you know, blah, 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 like that. A lot of things are packed in there. But don't get too caught up with the book. It's just recorded teachings and edited and published. It's always the personal experience. Personal experience. You can flip to any page, just read the words and then try to experience it. Try to experience it. And the principle is relax, ground, and then you can engage. Whatever method and what strings together all the different methods, all the different approaches, is the experiencing. The most raw, immediate, embodied experiencing. First, you may focus on the object of experience if you need to. Then slowly get a more palpable sense of this, just the experiencing itself. And then you can infuse that. Everything that you do, slowly. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I have a question, sir.
Sure.
So what would you say this is, like, especially when I'm in nature, you know, walking in the woods, and it's always been in nature that there's this just, you know, all the senses just shut down. And it's just like opens up, something just opens up. And that's how I wanted to know more about, I got your book and I haven't read it, but in the meanwhile. So it's just.
Yeah.
I can't find words for it.
Yeah. So it's easier in nature. It's not really our sense faculties shut down. It's actually they're completely, I wouldn't say overwhelmed, they're completely open to that presence. So they become very alive. And the discursive faculty, that is the mind faculty, that is being inundated, incapacitated by all the sensory embodied experiencing. You see? So it's not the sensory shutdown. It's actually, it's just the awe, the presence of nature. So usually in daily life, it's our discursive thinking that's ba 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 ba. So that kind of dominates. So what we need to do is to learn to come to the body, like what we practice. We're not using the faculty of the mind, nor are we using the ear, nor are we using the smell. Just body first, one sense faculty at a time. Just experiencing the body, relaxing. Once you have a ground, then slowly opening the other senses. And allow the faculty of discursive thinking to recede in the background. No words, no language. Then when you experience in daily life, people are screaming, yelling, busy. You can also experience them like trees. You just open, avail yourself. The wonder, the amazing, amazingness of people. Don't get caught up in the content, the discursiveness, words and language, just experiencing. So what we try tonight is the embodied experiencing. So I slowly guided you all. So this dimension slowly diminishes. So the sensory faculty start to open up. So practice that. Practice that. Yeah. All right. Anyone else?
Okay. I have one more question, if that's okay.
Yes.
So I was wondering if you could elaborate on how exactly awakening takes place through the method of silent, or not method necessarily, but through silent illumination, in contrast to the more well-known Gong'an method. You know, you always hear about people like breaking through a Gong'an. There's that moment where suddenly they're, before they were not Buddhas, and now suddenly they're Buddhas. You know, I was wondering how does this process take place in the context of silent illumination? Is it, you know, like longer, slower, or I remember one time you said that silent illumination is the long way or something. I don't know if that's correct.
More gentle. It's not the long way. Okay. So some of you, I'm not sure if all of you have heard the word Gong'an or Huato, critical phrase. This is another method in Chan. One is not better than the other. It's not that there's a magic, you know, Gong'an is the magic pill for, you know, the sudden awakening. It's not really the method, the approach. It's actually how one practices. Like I said, these methods cannot stand by itself. No method, Buddhist method, or any method, can stand by itself. It is the life, the way one carries oneself in life, and engaging Dharma practice. The most rudimentary way of phrasing this is virtue, body, speech, and mind, meditation, which encompasses different aspects of life, and then correct views, or wisdom. We may not have wisdom yet, so we borrow and we reflect on the wisdom of the Buddhas, his teachings, as a compass to kind of slowly align ourselves with it. So there are many different rubrics. This is the most simple one. Three higher learnings. Jie Ding Hui. So it is this ground, this context, that primes the person to have an experience, a breakthrough, or some experience of awakening. And we don't, that's my basic answer to you. Silent illumination and Huato practice incorrectly, meaning, you know, one's sitting very well, but the person's basically still very selfish in daily life. You know, that kind of grasping is very strong. It's just an exercise. It doesn't mean anything. Nothing really happens. So the causal ground must be in alignment with the lessening of vexations, self-referential grasping that manifests through greed, aversion, jealousy, arrogance, all that. Lessening. How do we do that? We borrow Buddha's wisdom. We reflect, we come across it, reflect on them, start to integrate them. And the resistance will come up. That becomes our path. So our path unfolds as we align ourselves with Buddha Dharma. That these resistances, you know, hang-ups will manifest. That's precisely what the practice is. So we learn to expose, we learn to embrace them, work through them. And we have, our life is virtuous, is harmonious, steady. meditation practice is infused into daily life, the way we see things, the way we perceive and understand things is in alignment, the self-referential grasping diminishes. You see? Then the method. Only then will the method work. It doesn't really matter, silent illumination or hot dog. And mostly, this is my critique of, I don't know if this, is this being recorded? Okay. This is my critique of phrase it lightly. My critique of the koans system. You know, pass through one, pass through two, pass through three. Most of these passing through kind of breakthroughs or pass through these koans are not really or not necessarily awakening experiences. The kind of embodied, intuitive understanding or insight. So like a perfect alignment with correct view. Koans are different stories, so it's different scenarios that one finds oneself, essentially. So in these live circumstances, suddenly you have a flash of kind of intuitive understanding or a kind of oneness. Now, oneness is not awakening, at least from the Chan perspective. From Chan's perspective, these states of oneness, intuitive insights, not necessary. So you have to work with the teacher, the teacher will know. So it's not like you pass through 100 koans, you have 100 awakenings. No. So these insights are helpful because they bring to life correct views of Buddha Dharma. So in that sense, they kind of come at life from different angles. Genuine breakthroughs. Yeah. These koans just go through all of them. Yeah. The different angles that come, you will not be able to be caught up or kind of experience an impasse. If you do, then the awakening is maybe shallow, if it is. Genuine awakening. So, for most of us, I encourage you not to dwell too much about that. Not to dwell too much on that. If you think too much about it, then we kind of bring up the seeking mind, you know, grasping for experiences that kind of backfires. It's Buddha Dharma in our lives, and where we are caught up with our resistances. That is the path that unfolds before us, that shows us, reveals to us what needs to be done, what can be done. That's practice. Endless. In different scenarios of life, we see all kinds of things. Okay?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Blessings to all of you. May you be well. May your practice protect you in different circumstances of your life. May you bring this practice to benefit all those around you.